During my years of being a very gullible and impulsive teenager, out of all the games that I ended up borrowing from kids that were a couple years older than me, there was a certain game that hit me harder upside the head than I ever could have imagined it doing. And that game was Haunting Ground. Poor, unsuspecting teenage Sophie didn't know what she was about to experience, and although she should probably have respected the game's mature rating, she was also way too curious for her own good. Which led to many sleepless nights, but also one of the most immersive video game experiences. This video will contain spoilers for the game, so heads up if you haven't played it and if you are planning to do so in the future. If you've already played the game, or if you simply just don't care, feel free to safely keep on watching. The one area where Haunting Ground really shines is in its ability to make you feel vulnerable. Of course, making you feel helpless is a huge part of a lot of horror games, so I'm not exactly praising the game for doing what a horror game is supposed to do, which is make you feel scared and uncomfortable. I want to praise it for how well it utilizes the objectification of its main character to hit all of the right, or I guess wrong, notes. Bad notes? Uncanny notes? Yucky notes? Who knows, I'm sure you catch my drift. For a bit of backstory, Haunting Ground, also known as Dementia, is a 2005 survival horror game published by Capcom. Fiona Belli, the game's main protagonist, is a wide-eyed 18-year-old who, one night, after being involved in a car crash whilst riding together in a car with her parents, wakes up in a large mansion only to quickly realize that she's been kidnapped following the events of the crash. And right off the bat, we're bombarded by unsettling elements. Fiona wakes up alone in a place that's completely foreign to her. She has no idea where she is, and she has no one to ask for help, which is already an unnerving situation, only made worse by the fact that she's also put in nothing but a sheet, meaning that her clothes and any valuables that she might have had on her were stripped away from her when she was unconscious, which is another scary factor, the idea of someone moving you around and undressing you while you are unconscious. And she doesn't exactly wake up on a king-sized bed, but rather inside a small iron cage in what looks to be like a rogue butcher shop. From here on out, it's up to Fiona to traverse the mansion in order to find her way out as she escapes from the multiple stalkers inhabiting the mansion. So, the game not only forces her into an unknown location, but it also adds the element of being chased. Fiona is continuously objectified and dehumanized. Each and every one of the game's villains show a different and very twisted desire and/or lust towards Fiona. Although his true intentions are a bit blurred due to his inability to properly communicate, Debilitas keeps mentioning how he wants to keep Fiona as his doll. His intent for chasing Fiona could arguably be seen as the least malicious, as it's not made clear whether he understands that he is hurting Fiona whenever he captures her. If he only sees her as a doll or a toy, it could imply that he doesn't understand that she is a person that can feel pain. Which could be why he's often seen throwing Fiona's body around like a rag. So, either he doesn't understand, or he has the full intention of picking Fiona apart with joy. But regardless of whether Debilitas is aware or not, it doesn't make the situation any less terrifying for Fiona. All she knows is that a large man that could snap off her spine in a matter of seconds is chasing her around, calling her his doll, picking her up and throwing her on the ground like she's a stuffed animal. The second antagonist that Fiona comes across is Daniela, the resident housekeeper. Although Daniela certainly isn't normal at any point during any encounter, initially, her intent does not come across as malicious. She's unsettling, for sure, but she's not chasing you right off the bat. It isn't until later that the player finds out about Daniela's deep-set jealousy towards Fiona. As it turns out, Daniela is unable to feel anything. She has no sense of joy or sadness. She cannot feel pain or pleasure and despises Fiona for being so human. And therefore what is essentially her opposite. Because Daniela herself is infertile, she hates Fiona for her ability to carry children. That, along with her beauty and how desired she is by Lorenzo, who is Daniela's master, it doesn't take much to see how Daniela's jealousy came to grow. She calls Fiona a pretty little princess and accuses her of luring men into her body. She calls Fiona filthy and shames her on numerous occasions without remorse. After taking Daniela down, Fiona soon runs into Ricardo, a clone created from the same man as Fiona's own father, essentially making him her uncle. In general, Ricardo has a disregard for both emotion and any life that isn't his own. He only sees being understanding of others and being compassionate as obstacles on the track to obtaining knowledge, and only wants to use Fiona for his own gain, repeatedly threatening Fiona to give herself up to him and become the lady of the castle, claiming he owns her and treating her being like his property. Lastly, Fiona's final enemy is Lorenzo, a man who sees Fiona as one thing and one thing only, a vessel for him to become immortal. Much like Ricardo, Lorenzo only wants to use Fiona for her Azoth in order to become immortal. That is all that Fiona is to him, an offspring of his clone for him to use as he pleases. Both Lorenzo and Ricardo see Fiona as their own property rather than an independent human being. Rather than seeing her as a person, all that Fiona is to them is just the Azoth. She's reduced to being the carrier of the one thing that would benefit them. So, throughout your Haunting Ground experience, you'll not only be dehumanized, objectified, and body shamed, but also both physically and mentally abused. Needless to say, this was a bit much for mid-puberty Sophie to take in. I remember finding this game exhausting to play when I was younger because I would always be so on edge. Where the game really shines is in its ability to make you feel like a rat trapped in a labyrinth with a group of scientists peeking down on you to observe your every move. Very few games are as good at emulating this feeling as Haunting Ground is. Although Haunting Ground is considered a spiritual successor to games like Clock Tower, and there have been many games that have come afterwards that have emulated a similar claustrophobic setting, to me, personally, none have ever made me feel as trapped as Haunting Ground has. It's made abundantly clear that although you can hide inside the mansion, you're never really safe. You're always in enemy territory with no one to help you get out. Not to mention that Fiona is not only just a teenager, but she's also a normal art student. She's not a bounty hunter or an undercover detective out on a job to investigate the mansion. She is a very gentle girl who is more than likely suffering from some sort of anxiety disorder. She is physically weaker than the stalkers. She doesn't have the same access to their weapons, and she doesn't know the layout of the actual mansion, constantly putting her at a disadvantage to everyone else. So, why would I still want to talk about this game? Well, because I strongly believe that the reason that Haunting Ground not only scared me as much as it did, but also left such a strong impression, was because of when I played the game. People saying how playing a certain game at a certain point in their life led to a very special experience isn't anything groundbreaking. Although I would probably still have been properly creeped out playing it at my current age, it wouldn't have hit the same notes for me due to the fact that I'm just more matured. Not in a sense that I've somehow grown out of being scared by horror games, or that you can just suddenly outgrow being scared of the horror genre, but I've been desensitized in a sense. Which leads me to my point and why Haunting Ground managed to leave such an impression on me. Because I experienced it as a teenager, specifically a teenage girl. I am speaking from experience when I say that it was incredibly easy to relate. Playing as someone like Fiona, who was only a few years older than I was at the time, running around a huge mansion being chased by people you didn't know if they were trying to either kill you, sexually abuse you, eat you, or maybe even all three, was a panic-inducing scenario, to say the least. If you know the bad guy is just planning on shooting you in the back of the head and ending it then and there, it's not as scary as opposed to someone who you don't know if they're gonna kill you, eat you, and or assault you. Although you'll surely be able to put yourself in Fiona's shoes regardless of if you're 16 or if you're 35, you know, as long as you've got the imagination, nothing's stopping you. Being chased by a stalker who, very aggressively, mind you, demands to be led into your womb. I think it's bound to hit harder for a teenage girl than it is for, let's say, a guy in his mid-20s. You know, in my mind, that's not an unreasonable hypothesis. In games like Amnesia or Alien Isolation or Soma, it's easier to relate regardless of where you find yourself on the gender spectrum, because the gender of the main character isn't really relevant. But because of how much Haunting Ground emphasizes Fiona's sexual attributes and fertility in very explicit ways, it's not unreasonable to imagine that it would hit harder for a girl. Without having been trapped in a murder mansion stuck with ruthless killers, most young girls can relate to the fear of being reduced to being nothing but your body. And having that kind of fear amplified in a horror setting is not only scary, but it also gets under your skin because, although it's only by a long shot, it still hits home to a certain extent. A good example of an opposite situation that comes to mind would be the whistleblower DLC from Outlast. No, surely no one finds the idea of having their genitals mutilated comforting, but specifically having your ding-dong almost cut off unwillingly is bound to be a bit more frightening for the people that have one. Although, Whistleblower does again loop back to the main character running away from possibly getting impregnated. Anyway, I do realize that I am indeed outing myself by making this video, because yes, I did play Haunting Ground despite being underage. That's just one of the glories, or I suppose horrors, of borrowing games from older friends. So although mid-teenage girls aren't exactly the target demographic for a game like Haunting Ground, I do earnestly think that my experience was heightened by the fact that I did play it as a teenager. Don't misunderstand though, I am definitely not advocating for underaged kids to ignore mature ratings on video games. But in this particular case, I only really had myself to blame. I saw the mature rating and I full-on ignored it. And although it was positively terrifying to go through it for the first time, it ended up paying off as it's now one of the most memorable games I've played. I can't recommend that anyone underage play it though with a clear conscience, but then again, I did play it when I was underage, so really, who am I to talk? I can only assume that, as a teenager, I found the idea of being forcibly separated from my parents, only to be treated like a piece of dog meat by weird strangers inside of a big mansion, even more scary than I would do now as someone who is of age. Losing control and being objectified isn't a good feeling for anyone, but as a teen, I found it to be way more scary. Haunting Ground uses its perverse and grotesque nature to continuously make the player uncomfortable. Outside of this horror game about a crazy old alchemist trying to use this poor young woman to his own gain in order to become immortal, the game explores themes like mental illness, emotional and sexual abuse, body dysmorphia, incest, and, of course, gore. It goes beyond just having Fiona be the eye candy to get the player interested. Fiona is undoubtedly eye candy, but the people that are trying to get at her can and will kill her if she's captured. The fact that you're playing as the eye candy is what's stripping all of your power away from you. Haunting Ground doesn't treat Fiona's sexualization as something positive, but it emphasizes how desired she is by a group of people that want to either kill or impregnate her. Of course, there's the argument that it's only obvious that I would feel scared playing Haunting Ground as I wasn't of age to play it. But Haunting Ground wasn't the first horror game that I played at that point in my life. I had played multiple titles before even touching Haunting Ground, but none of them stuck with me in the same horrifying way that Haunting Ground did. As an adult, although I do find it very strange to say it, I think the ideal way for the game to really transfer its disgusting take on horror is for it to be played by late teenage girls. That's not to say that I would encourage underage people to play it, but if you are in the same age range as Fiona, there is no denying that the game is definitely more terrifying. In short, I can safely say that after having played Haunting Ground all those years ago, I did regret it. There were times I wish I hadn't started it and that the one older kid hadn't recommended it to me, but as an adult, I'm still so happy that I went through with it because it still stands out in my memory till this day. So, although all experiences may not be fun when you're going through them, it might be worth it in the long run. And please remember to pray to Capcom for a Haunting Ground remaster. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you.